Good evening.
Good evening.
Appreciate the opportunity to speak to y'all tonight. Jesse's asked me before we started if I was going to keep y'all here till midnight, but I think most of y'all know me. I'm pretty, not really, I'm not a man of many words, so it's going to be short and sweet. The title of my lesson is Defending Our Faith Against Doubt. We all have doubt in our lives. I would say, like, I had many doubts when I was in college whether I was going to make a good grade on a test. I think a lot of that came from the amount of time I prepared for it, but I still had my doubts. I didn't have any doubts yesterday until about the fourth quarter, and I kind of lost all hope and I started having my doubts. But doubt can be a dangerous thing when it comes to our faith. If we allow it to, it'll slowly take us away from God. First, doubt, I want to talk about how doubt is different than disbelief. While doubt hinders our faith, doubt does not mean that we completely disbelieve something. It's an occasional inability to admit the truthfulness of a particular claim. The word doubt carries with it a sense of being unstable, wavering, being of two minds, or contending with oneself. It also talks in the Bible about being lukewarm. This would be a similar word. It's kind of like straddling a fence. You can't make up your mind whether it's true or not. So let's look at two examples of people that had doubt. If you'd like to follow along, you can turn to Matthew chapter 14. And I'll start in verse 22. That's Matthew 14, verse 22. This is a very familiar passage. It's talking about Jesus when he walked on the water. And the subject that we're looking at is Peter. I'm going to start at verse 22. Immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he sent the crowds away. After he had sent the crowds away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. And when it was evening, he was there alone. But the boat was already a long distance from them, and battered by the waves, for the wind was contrary. In the fourth watch of night, he came to them, walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter said to them, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." And Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came towards Jesus. But seeing the wind, he became frightened and began to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and took hold of him and said to him, "You have little faith. Why did you doubt?" When he got back into the boat, the wind stopped. Jesus was coming to them on the water, and Peter sees him walking on the water, and he wants to go out there with Jesus, so Jesus allows him to. But it wasn't until Peter took his eyes off of Jesus that he started to sink. And Jesus said that he doubted. We can relate that to us whenever, like in our lives, sometimes whenever we don't focus on what we need to be focused on, then that's when doubt can easily arise in our minds. If we're not focused on Jesus like we should be, then we allow other things to creep in our mind, and that is where doubt can start. I also wanted to note that Jesus said, "You have little faith," not "you have no faith." Doubt doesn't necessarily mean that you don't believe at all, but it just means that your faith is hindered. The second passage we'll look at is found in John chapter 20, starting at verse 24. That's John chapter 20, starting at verse 24. This is after Jesus had raised from the dead. He was seeing all his disciples. Verse 24. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples were saying to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands an imprint of the nails, and put my fingers in the place of the nails, and put my hand in his side, I will not believe." After eight days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas with them. Jesus came, the doors having been shut, and stood in their midst. And he said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Reach here with your finger, and see my hands. And reach here with your hand, put it in my side. And do not be unbelieving, but believe." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord, my God." Jesus said to him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who did not see and yet believe." Thomas failed to listen to all Jesus' teaching about his death and that he would rise again. Thomas even had some of his closest friends tell him that they had seen Jesus, but still he didn't believe. It wasn't until he could actually have physical evidence that he changed his mind. So how does doubt affect our lives? James chapter 1, verses 5 through 8 says, "But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. Who gives all generously without reproach, and it will be given to him. But he must ask in faith without doubting. The one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways." God is willing to help us in our lives, and the way we ask that help is prayer. But how can we ask God to help us if we don't even really believe that He's going to answer our prayer? Another passage that I'm going to talk about, I'm only going to read two verses from it, but I'm going to summarize a little bit, and that's Romans chapter 14. In Romans 14, you have some Christians that are debating over whether it's okay to eat meat and sacrifice to idols, and does it really make that big a difference. But it even says in verse 3 how it really doesn't make a difference. But I'm going to read verses 23 that shows what doubt does to your beliefs. "The faith which you have, that is your own conviction before God. Happy is he who does not condemn himself in what he approves. But he doubts is condemned if he eats, because his eating is not from faith. And whatever is not from faith is sin." In verse 3 it says it doesn't matter. But then later on it says that just because you doubt it, then that's when it becomes a sin. So how do we defend against doubt? The last passage I want to read is going back to John chapter 20, verse 30 and 31. And it says, "Therefore many signs Jesus also performed in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name." It's kind of ironic that was written right after Thomas's ordeal, where he didn't believe. Here it's pretty much, it's written out that these are all written so that we may believe. So our belief comes from something, and that would be the Word of God. While Jesus was on earth, people came to believe from miracles and his teachings. But today we get our belief from the Bible. So whenever we have doubt that creeps into our mind, how do we battle against it? By studying the Bible. If we leave doubt unresolved in our lives, it can damage, weaken, and even destroy our faith. I'm going to close with a quote that seemed to sum it up pretty good, I thought, by a man named Gary Parker. I don't know anything about him, I just found this quote, but it says, If faith never encounters doubt, if truth never struggles with error, if good never battles with evil, how can faith know its own power? In my pilgrimage, if I have to choose between a faith that has shared doubt, that has stared doubt in the eye, and made it blink, or a naive faith that has never known the firing line of doubt. I'll choose the former every time. If we can't allow doubt to come into our lives and to make us stray from the Lord, but if we do have doubt, we have to study those things out and to realize what the truth is. As long as we are always fighting the doubts that we have, it's not making us weaker, but it's making us a stronger Christian. That concludes what I have tonight. But of course, we're going to offer the invitation. Tonight you can come if there's anything that you need, but always remember that the invitation is always open, whether you're here or some other place. You can always talk to any brother about any problems that you have. But if tonight you have something that you need to put forth in prayer, you need baptism, whatever, come as a stand there.